To get the entire episode and all our content, look for A Podcast of Biblical Proportions on all podcasting platforms. Hello, everybody, and welcome to A Podcast of Biblical Proportions. Episode 11, The Tower of Babel. The Tower of Babel is another short and iconic biblical story from the book of Genesis. Like the stories we've covered up to now, this one too has deep local roots and is a sort of archetypical tale that serves to explain the peculiar phenomenon of having different people all over who speak in languages we don't understand. So we want to explore that, as well as the other parallel tower and language stories, the word plays, the form, and how it has stayed relevant for thousands of years. Hi, Omri.
Hi, Gil.
Just to retell the story very shortly, it's a miniature story. It's like two paragraphs. Okay, so the post-flood humans, they built a city and a tower to live near each other. And then Yahweh came down, mixed up their languages, so they gave up and were spread across the world.
Mm-hmm.
The end. That's it.
Yeah.
Okay, so what do you make of this story?
I think if in the first episodes, in the creation, we had some kind of a chemistry and physics lesson, and inside of the creation story, we advanced to zoology, botanica, and biology. Later with the dynasties and the lineages, we had a history lesson.
Nationalities.
Nationalities with Noah. And now it's kind of a linguistic lesson. To me, it's the fascinating part of it is that you had something that you had to explain. The early people who lived in the ancient world concerned themselves with the question, how come we have so many different languages and dialects? Even now, the study of languages in a cognitive sense, in a mathematical sense, in the linguistic sense, if you study linguistic, you need to have some kind of a mathematical way of thinking. Because it's not only the study of language and their meanings, it's just equations after equations after equations. The study of languages is in its infancy, even now. It's a major problem. Why we have so many languages?
And how? We want to know where the words originate. This is fascinating.
Yeah, it's something that you have to explain.
So it's not coincidence that you have that story in Africa, in Asia. We're going to talk about some of these stories later.
In the same manner that it's no coincidence that people in Africa and in Asia and the Americans, in the Americas have languages.
How?
Yeah, we don't know. We still don't know how we have languages. It's probably something to do with the neurons in our brain and something to do with the way our brain is calibrated. Animals have languages too. Just their languages are not symbolic.
Mm-hmm.
They have signals which describe immediate reality. Like
beware, predator.
Beware, predator from above. Yeah. Beware, predator from below. You have differences. You have even names. Dolphins have names.
Oh.
They can name names amongst each other.
Hmm.
But they can't say, if tomorrow will be rainy, then I might want to take my red umbrella and not the green one. That's something that their heads will explode. Even it's just something that doesn't exist in nature. They can't even describe and imagine it. Maybe the fact that we as human beings produce roughly two times the neurons in our frontal cortex, which is the part of our brains between the eyes, like the third eye that in the Indian mythology they speak about, the third eye. Their function is to regulate our emotions.
Aggressions.
And aggressions that come from a much more primitive side of our brains. Mm. The main difference between human beings and the next best thing, i.e. the bonobo chimpanzees, which are like 99.7% similar genetically to humans.
Mm.
The major difference is the production of neurons. Maybe the side effect of the extra production of neurons creates some kind of an abstract way of thinking that you have extra neurons and they need to find some kind of a place in the world, so they imagine abstract concepts and symbols.
Mm.
And if you take that little difference across, I don't know,
millions, tens of thousands,
100,000s of years of evolution and evolution of language, maybe that's how we got languages. So maybe even somebody took a mushroom from a special kind of mushroom, and then his mind got exploded.
And they're not even trying to explain that, the appearance of language. They just want to explain how come there are
so many of them.
Let's talk about a little bit the form of the story. It's beautiful. It's a beautiful story. ויהי כל הארץ שפה אחת ודברים אחדים. In English, it's okay, but it loses a bit of the oomph. And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. So the format of the story is basically two paragraphs mirroring each other. Each sentence in the first paragraph mirrors the opposite sentence in the other paragraph. The first sentence mirrors the last sentence. The second sentence mirrors the second to last sentence. It's like a mirror image between the two paragraphs. It starts with the whole land was one language. It ends with Yahweh babbling, confounding the languages of all the land. So when in the first paragraph it says that they all want to live in one place, in the corresponding mirroring paragraph, it says that they were scattered. So then like the third line mirrors the third to last line, and in the middle is Yahweh coming down to see. So the first paragraph is the building, the second paragraph is destroying. First paragraph is the rise, and the second mirroring paragraph is the opposite action, the fall. And there's also all these word plays. Hava nilbena levenim, let's build bricks.
Yeah.
But it's Hava nilbena levenim. It sounds blah, 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 blah. Nivne lanu, again. And
Karash ma bavel ki sham balal Yahweh sfat kol haaretz. Bavel balal.
Bavel balal. The, okay.
First of all, the name is Bavel.
Bavel?
In the Hebrew pronunciation, it's Bavel.
But it's translated as Babel and not as Babylon.
Yeah.
Because it's probably not Babylon, because here it says that they left the city, deserted the city, stopped building it. And Babylon still existed back then. So the what the scholars think is just Balal, the Levalbel, to confound, to confuse. It sounds like Bavel. So, and they don't mind that it's not accurate.
Yeah.
So they just call it Bavel, but it doesn't seem to be the Bavel that is that appears in the book, in the rest of the book.
It probably is. And it's that point is very interesting. Why is it Babel? Why not someplace else? So the fact that it's Babylon, maybe in the times that this story was told and written, probably the most powerful empire that ruled the Near East was Babylon. It was the Rome of their time, the United States of our time, or the Assyrians of a few years back or a few years later. So the fact that they chose Babel as the example...
Babylon.
As an example of a unified culture that once existed, was scattered by Yahweh, it's quite interesting. It's like... they give their audience and themselves, I think unconsciously, the best example of high civilization. And there, in that high civilization, there's the potential of humanity and also the danger in that potential. And you said that there's no moral of the story. I think there's no immediate moral, more like a cautionary tale in the manner of like the Icarus tale in the Greek mythology.
But it doesn't state that explicitly in the story, unlike other tower stories out there that say that this is the reason.
Yeah. But the reason here is God is actually afraid. God, Yahweh, is afraid of humanity. He says to himself, if they can build that kind of a monument, what's preventing them from reaching new highs and achieving their ultimate potential? And it's some kind of a similar message with the Garden of Eden story, the Yahweh story of the Garden of Eden. He banishes Adam and Chava from the Garden of Eden, not solely because they sinned, because he realizes that the minute they disobey him, they can also maybe even replace him. They can taste from the tree of knowledge and then have knowledge and be closer to me, And the next stage, they will taste from the tree of life, and then they will be immortal, and they will also be close to me. Here, they build a massive tower, and something interesting here is that it's like in the Greek mythology, they recognized fire as some kind of an advance in technology. That's why humans, stupid humans, needed God to steal the secret of how to make fire to reveal to them.
Okay.
Here it's here the major technology is bricks, is mixing materials, and instead of a clay hut or mud, it's bricks, it's walls, it's something special.
There's also fire there, like nilbena levenim, nilbena lhalbin. It also means like burning, when you burn
a sword. Yeah, it becomes white. So there's fire. Also. Burned to a fire. Burned to be burned.
So there are a lot of, so it's not only Balal, Bavel, Nilbena, Levenim, there's also Nisrefa, Lesrefa.
Yeah.
And then V'achomer V'alehem Lechemar. Like the material was for them clay.
Yeah.
But Chomer Chemar.
Yeah.
And also it would be good to remind ourselves that these stories were meant to be told aloud.
Yeah.
And listened to aloud. So all the word plays on the sounds, Bavel, Balal, Nilbena, Levenim. There's a pleasure in listening to those sounds being similar and opposite, more so than reading the sounds. Also, it's worth mentioning that the most beautifully written episode so far in terms of poeticness and choice of words and form is a story about language.
So there's some kind of a recognition of a technological advancement and a recognition that humans plus technology equals becoming closer to God. And the reason that God scatters all the humans from the Babylon is because he's afraid. He's afraid for the potential.
So I have a theory here. I think that this story is a late addition, just unsubstantiated theory, okay? Because first of all, this story, as we said, mirrors similar stories in the region. So what we do know about the Bible is that there are almost always additions in the editing process across hundreds of years and not so much subtractions.
Mm-hmm.
And this is such a short story that doesn't include the cautionary mm-hmm. tale part here implicitly, while it is included in other similar stories. So mm-hmm. maybe they didn't want to add it because it's just so perfect in terms of form. You don't want to ruin it.
Okay. I think that something that supports your theory, your hypothesis, is the fact that it's kind of a poem. In terms of it's like an art.
Haiku. It's like a haiku.
It's an art piece. It's something that the writers thought about and selected words to put there.
And the translation can't have any of that.
Yeah, sorry. And unlike the first episode that we read to you that were not so grammatically perfect and the play on words was minimal and was very apparent.
Yes.
So here it's like all the story is a play of words. There's a structure here. It's very short.
Mm.
So maybe it's not a totally late addition in terms that they wrote it later. Maybe it's some kind of a version of a story of some kind of a poem style Beowulf of the ancient world, some kind of a ancient story / song / poem / narrative.
Like
and
Hercules
the ending was later. Yeah.
Exactly. Like all these stories that you, and the ending was later.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's talk a little bit about parallels. There's the Enmekar and the Lord of Arata in the Sumerian and Assyrian stories. Ah, first of all, there's this ziggurat buildings in Uruk and other Assyrian and Babylonian cities, like real towers. It's like a terraced compound. Looks a little bit like the Parthenon. Mm. Where it's high above everything else. So that should be the tower that that they're all talking about.
Imagine.
To get the entire episode and all our content, look for A Podcast of Biblical Proportions on all podcasting platforms.